In the last video, we started configuring a small switch from the ground up. Now we're going to finish off the config and include a few tricks that you can use. We're getting back into it by getting the basic config underway. This stuff is pretty common, so I'll try to move through it fairly quickly to get to the more interesting bits sooner. First, the management IPs. These can be in-band or out-of-band. In this config, I'm configuring the dedicated out-of-band management interface ME0 with an IP address. For management to work correctly, we would normally need to configure a route as well. We're not going to do that right now, as that's something special that we're going to cover in detail in video 14. We can have an in-band management IP as well. This would generally be configured on a VLAN or IRB interface. Nothing here should be really surprising to you at this point. Let's not forget our DNS servers, which should be one of the easiest things in the world to do if I can type the command correctly. When I commit this, we get an error. To be honest, I forgot this would happen. We get a warning that DHCP is incompatible with the ME0 interface configuration. If we take a look at the ME0 interface, we can see that it has configuration for DHCP as well as a static IP. The DHCP config is there by default, and I added the static IP just a few moments ago. They can't coexist, so we have to remove one or the other. I'm going to remove the DHCP config. The commit process works again now. Setting the date is a bit different, as it's done with the set date command in operational mode. We can confirm the current time with show system uptime. This also includes stats around when the device booted. But that's too manual. I'd rather use NTP. Once again, this is simple. If we set more than one, we can add the prefer keyword to select the one we'd rather use. In this example, this fails. DNS is not working because I don't have a default route to the internet. As I said before, I'll fix that in another video. So what else do we need to configure? Let's not forget some basic SNMP config for management. I'm not going to go into detail into how SNMP works, as that's a topic all of its own, which you probably know anyway. On Junos, you just set a community and optionally configure traps to be sent to a server. You can dig through these commands further yourself if you want to. Let's work on management access next. There are two main ways to manage a Juniper device: the web console, called JWeb, and the CLI. For CLI access, we need to enable SSH. I should need to tell you why we're using SSH and not Telnet. JWeb is just as easy to enable. Just turn on Web Management HTTPS, and then tell Junos to generate a certificate locally. Self-signed certificates aren't ideal, but they'll be fine for our example. If you want to, you can add some more config to limit the interface that JWeb runs on, set custom ports, and so on. But I'll leave that for you to try out yourself. When we commit, Junos generates that self-signed certificate. I generally prefer the CLI for switch and router management, but you can have your own preference. Either CLI or web is fine. You don't have to be a tough guy who thinks that you only can use the CLI because that's what real network engineers do. If we log on to JWeb, we get a nice look at the device and which interfaces are up. We can look at the back too. As I move through the tabs, you can see the different types of things we can do in JWeb, like configuration, monitoring, maintenance, and troubleshooting. It's quite a useful web portal. I'll leave it up to you to explore JWeb further. You might remember that a few videos ago, I was talking about config files, which are stored in /config. Well, in addition to that, there's a special config backup called the rescue configuration. The plan is to get our devices into a good state and then create this rescue configuration file. Junos will put this config into rescue.conf.gz and place it in /config. When a device boots, it looks for juniper.conf.gz, which is our normal config file. If it were missing for any reason, perhaps due to corruptions, the switch will load the rescue config instead. If there's no rescue config, Junos will look for the previous version of the config. Anyway, the idea is that the rescue config is a known good state that we can recover our switch into if needed. It's not just for automatic recovery either. If we need to roll back to a good config in a hurry, the rescue config may be our fastest option. It can get you up and running while you figure out your next plan. We can create it with the command shown here. At a minimum, you should have the root password set, and you should have basic network configuration done so you can reach the device after rollback. You can even take a look at the rescue configuration if you want, much like you would look at the active config. Let's demonstrate the rescue config. First, I'll make some changes that I'm not happy with and commit it. Now, we simply use the rollback command, but instead of using a backup number, we use the rescue keyword. This rolls the candidate config back. If we're happy, we still need to commit it. Apparently, some large routers have a physical button on them that lets you automatically roll back to the rescue config. I've never seen one of these myself though. Maybe one day. Congratulations to us. Our switch now has basic configuration. Before we finish up, I suggest that we back up this config so we can use it as a template another time. We can't just use show run and copy to notepad like we might do on a Cisco switch. Junos config is stored in a hierarchy, but we generally apply config with set commands, so we can't just paste this into configuration mode. So, we have two options. The first is to backup the config, either by copying it to an FTP server, by using WinSCP, or even just using show configuration and copying the output to Notepad. This is structured data, so we can't just copy this into configuration mode. Instead, we can type load merge terminal. This tells Junos to expect structured config data. We then paste in our config and press Ctrl D when we're done. This is now part of the candidate config, which can be committed. Merge means we're merging the new config into the existing config. We could use load merge override to completely replace the config if we wanted to. There are a few other options you can use with this, which I'll put in the study notes if you want to take a look. Our second option is to export our config in a different format. When showing the configuration, pipe it through display set. This shows us the config as set commands rather than structured data. You can easily copy and paste this directly into configuration mode, just like you would on a Cisco device. If you don't like copying to Notepad, you can pipe through the save command to save the output to a file on disk. If you want to check that the config in a file is okay, use the test configuration command. It's easier than loading the config and running a commit check. I'm interested to know what you think about using web config on a router or a switch. I generally prefer CLI for routers and switches, but web config for firewalls. Let me know what you prefer in the comments. We've now completed part 2 of this series. Click the video shown here to begin part 3, where we start looking in depth at Junos hardware and software architecture.